Okay, now I have the pleasure to introduce Paul Snively to you. Paul Snively is going to talk today about formal logic. He is an experienced developer for 30 years, but he also has a background, unlike me, in physics. And today we are going to learn about formal logic. Please welcome Paul Snively.
Well, this is rather awkward. Did John not tell you that this is a formal logic workshop? I'm afraid no one here meets the dress code. So I'm going to, unfortunately, have to ask you all to proceed to the exit. Seriously, though, the point that I want to make is that there is a difference between formal and informal, and I think we all have an informal understanding of that. But what is the point of being formal? Why do we engage in formality? And to reiterate some points that Runar made this morning, formality or formalisms are constraints. And constraints liberate us. And I think one of the things that we might tend to forget in modern society is that social formalisms also liberate us in certain ways. They make us free to engage with other people in ways that are less likely to offend, that are easier to communicate in a consistent way. Of course, formal society has the notion of protocol, just as we do, of course, in software. So formality is a means of imposing constraints on a process in order to liberate that process, or in order to liberate our understanding of that process. Logic is no different. I have a strong suspicion that everybody here is fairly confident that they know how to reason logically. Okay, and I think one of the hallmarks of humanity, one of the hallmarks of rationality, is that we all have a reasonable handle on how to reason in an informal kind of way. Now, of course, humanity has not satisfied itself with that. Humanity has asked itself from ancient times how we can be sure that we're reasoning in a successful way. And that's fundamentally what this workshop is about. Not about informal logic, it is about formal logic. So the good news is that this is not a formal logic workshop. So, with that said, I don't suppose I need this anymore. Or this. We're all friends here. Right? So this is going to be an informal, if I can get out of this, which is also bloody hot, by the way, an informal formal logic workshop. It doesn't want me to get out. By the way, I discovered that that actually putting on a waistcoat is an interesting topological exercise. There. That should make things slightly easier. Ah, much better. So the formality is not in the event. The formality is in the logic. And one of the ways that we do logic formally is by using some symbols that we've evolved through many, many iterations, and unfortunately I don't have the time or the background for that matter, to share how these symbols that we use in formal logic have evolved. But the popular ones that we probably have all seen, at least when we were in school, maybe depending upon whether you studied math or computer science or logic formally, you know, you may or may not be familiar with. But of course we have the arrow for implication, we have this funny looking upward arrow thing for conjunction, for and. We have the V for or. Most Scala developers, especially those who use Scala Z, are familiar with that. And of course, we have a symbol for not. There are a couple of different symbols that commonly get used for not. And the ones that everybody sort of gets nervous and scared about, understandably, are called the quantifiers. And of course, there's for all and there's there exists. And we have this funny upside down A and we have this funny backwards E to signify that. Formal logic, in order to be formal, consists of taking these symbols and building sentences with them and kind of moving them around according to certain rules, okay, formal rules, and we try to get what? I mean, so the philosophers have spent a lot of time answering that question. Are we talking about truth? Are we talking about validity? Are we talking about provability? All that sort of stuff. Because this is a very computer science centric perspective on logic, we're going to be dealing with provability. We're just going to be dealing with the notion of can we prove something, can we not prove something, okay? And so the fist is there because we might actually have to, you know, do some actual violent shoving in order to get certain things to work. Okay, so the first thing we talk about, and by the way, the reason that I decided to do this workshop, or rather what this workshop is, is because for a few years now, some of you might have seen Amanda Locker's and my presentations in 2012 and 2014 about type systems and type theory and all this sort of stuff. And we talk about the Curry-Howard isomorphism, right? And we get up there and we say, types are propositions, okay? That's half of the Curry-Howard isomorphism. The other is that programs are proofs, right? So those are the slogans. And it occurred to me that most working programmers that I know don't have a computer science education, and let alone a formal logic education. And at least when I did my undergrad in the United States, we didn't have formal logic as part of our computer science curriculum in my undergraduate program. So I saw this gap. You know, it's like it's all well and good to talk about logic and propositions, but you know, if you haven't studied that, what does that mean? So very quickly, I just want to give some background. A proposition is a potentially true or false statement. That's it, very simple. And it doesn't matter whether you know whether it's true or not. It has to be true or false in principle. You know, could be true or false, you might not know. And in fact, typically in logic, you don't know. You're trying to prove a proposition. That's a big chunk of what we're trying to do. So here are some examples of propositions. The first one, I think, most people would regard as true. And the second one is unsolved, unknown. Maybe Eric has some idea as to whether it's true or false. The point is that a proposition is, you know, a statement that could be true or false. So I have to make an apology now because I am going to leave out a ton of important figures in the history of logic. I'm also going to leave out entire cultures. I am Western. I studied the Western logical tradition. Obviously, there are important logicians from China, India, many other cultures. But I am going to fast forward to George Boole, a self-taught British schoolmaster in the 19th century. And the reason I'm fast forwarding to Boole isn't just that we all know about Booleans and we all sort of use them every time we program. It's also because, and this is often overlooked, and in fact I can't recall ever hearing anybody talk about it. Even in Western logic, the logic tradition before the 19th century, when we talk about Euclid, when we talk about Aristotle and all this sort of stuff, very important certainly, Euclid gave us the axiomatic method for heaven's sakes. But the way that they represented logic was still in the vernacular. If you read Euclid, it is all Greek, you know, and in both senses of the word, okay, meaning it's in the vernacular. Aristotle, in the vernacular. All logic prior to Boole was expressed, is that true? Anyway, mostly true. Almost all logic prior to Boole was expressed in the vernacular. What Boole did was to have the brilliant insight that you could represent logic as algebra, and literally as one and zero, and multiplication is and addition is or. And I want to emphasize that point. I want to emphasize that last point there, that Boole was the one who identified a kind of a relationship or a kind of mapping from the notion of conjunction and multiplication and or to, or disjunction, to addition. That actually turns out to be a very important concept, which unfortunately we're going to have to come back to later, at least in the interest of time, but also because there's more information to relate to it. Another very important logician from the same era, Augustus De Morgan, corresponded with Boole and was one of the prime movers, if you will, in 19th century logic in saying, well, what's really primitive? What are the minimal things that we can take as either as axioms or as basic operations and say, this is all we need to represent any logical truth. And so one of the great insights that De Morgan had was that between and or, there's literally a dual relationship. We'll talk more about dual relationships a bit later. But what he meant by that is that given nothing but not, again, that's another, well, we talked about not a bit earlier. So given nothing but not and one of the others, and or, you can actually express the missing connective. You can represent or with not an and, or you can represent and with not an or. And that actually turns out to be, you know, many of you may have actually used De Morgan's law, that particular law of De Morgan's, there are several, in your daily work for one reason or another, maybe to simplify some complex conditional that was getting out of hand and needed to be simplified or needed to be related to some other connective that you know, you didn't want to change or couldn't change for some reason. Charles Lutwidge Dodson, one of my favorite people ever to walk the face of the earth. Okay, very clever guy. Turns out that if you take Charles and Lutwidge and reverse them, translate them back to their original Latin, and then re-anglicize them, you get Lewis Carroll. I think we all know who Lewis Carroll is, right? Even if you don't know who Charles Lutwidge Dodson was. In any case, his approach to teaching, and he did teach formal logic as an Oxford Don. His approach to teaching formal logic was to say, let's try to strip away everybody's sort of intuition, preconceptions that they bring to these problems of logic. And his approach to that, which he enjoyed very much, and lots of other people in the world have enjoyed very much, was through literary nonsense. So strip away all your intuitive interpretations, you know, the common sense, plain common sense reading, and you know, reinforce the process of manipulating logic in a way that's valid, even if it seems on the surface like it's nonsense. And of course, Alice in Wonderland and various other of his books are all about that. He was also a correspondent with many, 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 many of his readers of all ages. And I especially like this letter that he wrote to a 14-year-old correspondent in response to an algebra question. And I don't know how well you can read that here, hopefully better than I can. But what he has done here is he's posed a problem to, as he puts it, a distinguished algebraist, distinguished by height, by hair color, you know, things of that nature, and has posed him a terrible problem that he's had, where he provides certain values for these variables in algebra, and comes up with a contradiction, you know, comes up with nonsense, of course. And hopefully most of us can look at this very quickly and say, well, ha ha ha, you know, very clever. He snuck a division by zero into the problem. And one of the things, that is the problem. And I think that's very clever, but it also drives towards something that I really want to make a point of, and that is the problem with unsound reasoning is that it doesn't always show up as an exception thrown. It doesn't always show up as an infinite loop. It doesn't always show up as a core dump. Sometimes you just get nonsense. And that's the real danger of not being logically sound. You would hope that at least all of your logical unsoundness would show up at runtime in one form, one of the forms that I mentioned. Unfortunately, depending upon how your system is written, if the operations are done like you would follow the rules of algebra in this problem, that won't necessarily happen. You may get a result back. It just may not have any meaning. So really moving fast forward and ignoring a whole bunch of other important people, We get to Russell and Whitehead. And Russell and Whitehead, of course, are important figures in the history of mathematics and in the history of logic for what they, rather arrogantly, if I may say so, called the Principia Mathematica. The reason that's arrogant is because that's what Isaac Newton also named his famous treatise on physics. So Russell and Whitehead's Principia Mathematica took this program that arose out of the late 19th and early 20th centuries of founding all of mathematics on formal logic. That was the goal. That was Hilbert's program, for those of you who may be familiar with that. But Russell and Whitehead came up with a whole new formal logical system from scratch, completely original, and wrote these enormous two volumes in which they basically tried to lay out all of basic, you know, all of elementary mathematics in logical terms. They did it. They published actually at least two editions that I know of the Principia Mathematica, and it only took them about 450 pages to prove that 1 plus 1 equals 2. Okay, not the lightest reading and not the most effective or efficient way to go about adding 1 and 1 to be 2, but at least we have good reason to believe that it's true. Okay, but there were surprising gaps in the Principia Mathematica. In particular, substitution of variables was not treated at all, or rather it was not treated formally, I should say. It was treated informally. That's the surprise. The surprise of Principia Mathematica is how much was actually not formalized. And Alonzo Church came along and looked at the Principia Mathematica and said, I can do better. I am going to create a logic to replace the one from Russell and Whitehead. And it is going to treat substitution, it's going to treat application, it's going to treat abstraction, and that's it. It's actually a very Spartan, very sparse, very simple, very few rules logic. And it's called the lambda calculus. Something that is almost entirely lost, as far as I can tell, in computer science education today, is that the lambda calculus, the untyped lambda calculus, was and is a logic. It was designed as a logic, it was developed as a logic, and it was supposed to lay a new foundation, just like the Principia Mathematica was, for all of mathematics. It was supposed to replace the Principia Mathematica. And that was Church's goal, okay, with the lambda calculus. So all of a sudden, there's the direct connection from formal mathematical logic to computer science, although I'm not sure that Alonzo Church knew it at the time. Okay. Raymond Smullyan, also one of my favorite people ever, has written tons and tons and tons of books, logic puzzle books and logic textbooks. And he's also near and dear to my heart because he's at Indiana University, my alma mater. but that's irrelevant, that's unrelated. Anyway, he was also a student of Alonzo Church's, so that's who he studied logic under. And he has, in my mind, I say he's the, as you can see, he's the heir apparent to Lewis Carroll, because he, first of all, has amazing hair, and secondly, because he has written all these puzzle books very much in the spirit of Lewis Carroll. He loves to teach logic through puzzles. Okay, so that brings us to where this actually becomes a workshop. Because I have some puzzles, and I would like to work through them. And if I can get out of Keynote for just a second. I don't know how many of you had time to actually download and install all the tools that are referred to on the wiki, on the Scala World Wiki. For those of you who were great, please do follow along. For those of you who are not, please shout out comments or questions. By the way, I should mention that I'm going to change John's ground rules a little bit for this, because it is a workshop. I'm not going to stand up here and lecture for an hour and a half. And this is not about the tools, okay? This is not a Coq tutorial. This is not a PeaCoq tutorial. Those are just vehicles that I happen to be using to try to explain a bit about formal logic with a proof assistant that happens to be pretty nice, I think. So if you do have these installed, then cabal.cabalsandbox/bin/peacock and give it a port. 8000 is as good as any. And then fire up your browser. And yes, I know it's not by default. Thank you. And go to, obviously, if I can type, yeah, whatever port you assigned when you started Peacock. Okay, so in the downloaded materials, there's a file called template.v that you should load. And I've done a little bit of the legwork, again, because this is not a Coq tutorial. I've done a little bit of preliminary legwork. We're going to visit what Smullyan calls the island of knights and knaves. Okay, and the background is that on the islands of knights and knaves, knights always tell the truth and knaves always lie. Period. That's a guarantee. That's an assumption you get to make. Yes?
Can you make the fonts larger on this?
Can I make the fonts larger?
Command plus or something.
Yeah.
Nice. Awesome.
Better?
Maybe
down one from there, is that good?
That's good, yeah.
Okay, terrific. Okay, so on the islands of knights and knaves, knights always tell the truth and knaves always lie. And we're going to visit the islands of knights and knaves and we're going to ask some of the natives some questions. So first of all, just to get the ball rolling and get some syntactic stuff out of the way, I've defined the fact that we have a set of natives. I've defined a handy predicate, a logical predicate, which basically takes a native to a proposition. Prop is short for proposition, okay? So whether a native is a knight or not is true or false, and so native implies proposition, and that arrow there, of course, is the logical implication arrow, right? So when you see native arrow prop, that's native implies some proposition, which could be true or false. And then there's a little bit of syntax here, because we're going to ask the natives questions, and the natives are going to say something. And the key thing to understand in these puzzles is that if a knight, who always tells the truth, states a proposition, says something, then what they say is true. Conversely, if a native says a proposition that's true, then that native is a knight. And so you can see in the definition of says here that there's a double arrow there and head on both ends, pointing both directions. That's called by implication. You don't necessarily need to know that. You might also have heard it referred to as if and only if. So if one side is true, then the other side is true. If one side is false, then the other side is false. Logical equivalence. So if a knight says something, it's true. If a native says something that's true, they're a knight. Otherwise, it's the other way around. And there's a little syntactic sugar just to let us say says and things. And that's basically it. So let's take our first visit to the islands of knights and knaves. So we go to the islands of knights and knaves and we encounter three natives. Let's call them A, B, and C, and they are natives. Okay, so we go to A, and we say, what type are you? Are you a knight or a knave? And A says something, but he mumbles, and we can't quite make out what he says. So we turn to B and say, what did A say? And B says, A said he's a knave. And C gets very angry and indignant, jumps up and down and says, don't believe that, it's a lie, he's lying. What is C? A knight or a knave? Okay, and I guess the first question we have to ask ourselves is it even possible to answer this question, right? We didn't hear what A said. We have B making some assertion, making some claim, and we have C about A, which we didn't hear. And then we have C making some assertion about B, who's making an assertion about A that we didn't hear, right? So is it possible to answer this question? And actually, that's a serious question. Somebody, okay, so I'm sorry, yes?
Yes.
Do we have any no's? Good, because it is possible to answer that question, otherwise I wouldn't have used it, would I? Okay, so the next question is, how do we represent the logical situation that we have. So we have a couple of hypotheses. A hypothesis gets under your thesis like a hypodermic gets under your skin. So we have a hypothesis which I'll call B says, and it looks a lot like this. B says something, right? And what did B say? B said that A says that he's not a knight. So he's a knave. A knave is not a knight, right? So knights always tell the truth, knaves always lie. So we have a predicate called knight. So not knight is knave, right? So that's how that looks. And we have another hypothesis, which is C says. And C says, doesn't actually matter, it's just a name. C says, not knight, B. Or B is a knave, because he called B a liar, right? And now we would like to prove our theorem. What is our theorem? Knight C, right? And we've decided that it's possible to prove, well, we've decided the problem is solvable, right? But we want to prove either knight C or knave C, or not knight C, right? Anybody have any ideas to which it is?
Let's say that C is a knight.
But why? Can somebody actually explain the reasoning?
No person is going to say they're a knave. If someone's a knight, they say that they're a knight. If someone's a knave, they would say that they're a knight. So B must be lying
either way. There you go. So asking a native on the island of knights and knaves what they are is a not helpful question, exactly because a knight will never lie and claim to be a knave, and a knave will never tell the truth and claim to be a knave. So the only answer you're ever going to get is, I'm a knight. So B said that A said that he was a knave, so B is a knave and is lying. So C said B is lying, so C is a knight. So that's the theorem we actually want to prove, which we now believe. But that's our intuition, right? This is all, you know, we've all done this informal reasoning. So now it would be good to actually get a proof assistant to confirm or deny. Okay. And what I just did, in case that was too fast, was to put the cursor at the end of the line with the theorem and say, go to cursor in Peacock. Okay, and this is really nice because I stumbled across this just about a month ago, and really am happy with it because it gives you this graphical display, of course, of what your current understanding is. That's called the proof context on the left, or actually in the green outline, and then things you can try to move the ball forward in terms of proving the theorem. And what the proof context would look like if you took that step on the right. So let me see. I'm going to try to help us along a little bit by cheating ever so slightly by unfolding some definitions. So unfolding a definition in Coq just means replacing the nice little syntactic sugar with its actual expanded definition, kind of like resolving a macro or something like that. So I want to unfold my underscore says in everything. That's what the star means. And I also want to unfold, unfold not in everything as well. And I'm going to go ahead and go to caret again. Notice that the caret is after the period, after all that. Okay. So now I've unfolded says and not. And I think this makes the logical situation rather clear, right? Because it says basically, if B is a knight, then the implication is that A is a knight and not a knight, right? So there's a clear contradiction there. Of course, we have that if C is a knight, then B is not a knight, which is the thing that we believe, which is the thing we want to prove. So how do we go about doing that? I mean, it's clear enough to us intuitively, but as an exercise in moving these symbols around and kind of confirming our intuition about this, how do we go about that? And it's really kind of interesting, right? You know, we're trying to prove knight C, that's on the bottom there. You know, it's under the line. That's the thing we're trying to prove. And if we click in this lower pane and use the up and down arrow keys, we can see the things that are available for us to try. If we want to take, the theorem prover's word for it, the proof assistant's word for it. A quick word here, if you want to totally cheat, choose first order. because as you can see, there's nothing on the right of it, which means that, yeah, it'll actually prove this theorem for us. That's not what we want to do. We want to try to actually get some understanding. So we're going to do it the hard way. And so another thing that I want to do here is those by implications, those double arrows, they're perfectly fine. They're not that hard to understand. But it's actually more helpful for our purposes today, I think, if we just separate those out into both of the arrows, you know, pointing in the same direction. And a way we can do that is with a little command called destruct, which is short for destructure. And I want to destructure B says, and I want to destructure C says. And what that can go to caret. I'm going to be going to caret a lot, so I'll just stop talking about it. So as you can see, what that's done for us is it's added several more hypotheses to the proof context, given them completely made up artificial names. But you can see that they're simpler in the sense that the arrows are just normal arrows. They always point to the right. It's just taken that double arrow and said, okay, rip it out into one that points, you know, to the assumption to the conclusion, and then take the other direction and reverse it and have that be the assumption pointing to the conclusion. So the arrow goes to the right both times. So it's plain old implication at this point. And now it's interesting because we see that having done that, one of our hypotheses, which is H2, has knight C as a conclusion. Anytime one of your hypotheses has the thing you want to prove as a conclusion, it's really good news because you can very simply, if we scroll down a bit past the big hammer of first order, we can just apply H2, apply hypothesis 2. And as you can see, looking on the left side and the right side, the left pane and the right pane, what you get is a replacement of the current thing you're trying to prove with whatever leads to the conclusion and the implication that you're applying, right? So if we apply H2 here, then we're going to wind up having to prove that knight B is false, which, again, we've concluded is the case, right? We've concluded that B is not a knight, B is a knave. So apply H2. If we click on that, it did work. Yeah, there we go. Okay. Now, there's something else interesting to observe here. First of all, we have the arrow, meaning implication, and we just did something called apply, which sounds an awful lot like function application, doesn't it? There's a good reason for that, and that's because it is, according to the Curry-Howard isomorphism, where implication is a function type, and you apply a hypothesis, or you apply the proposition to a proof. A proof basically a function transforms a proof to another proof, as far as Curry-Howard is concerned. That's getting ahead of ourselves a little bit. Let's leave it right there for now. But that is the reason that apply is called apply, and you apply it to an arrow, to an implication. You're applying a function. That's all that's going on. Okay, so now we want to prove that knight B is false. First, the great thing about implication, especially in I guess this is specific to constructive logic. Constructive logic means it's computable. That's actually not entirely true, but again, let's leave it there for now. You can introduce the left side of the implication as an assumption, and now all you have to do is prove false. Well, it's hard to prove false, you know? It's hard to prove something that's false. So what this really means is we're saying there must be a contradiction somewhere in the context. Logically speaking, there's something about all the stuff that we have assumed up to this point that's above the line, right, inside the green box. There's something contradictory about that, and we know that there is, right? If B is a knight, then A is both a knight and not a knight, which can't possibly be the case. So really all we're doing is we're teasing that out. We're trying to surface that contradiction, basically, is what we're trying to do here. So what can we do to prove false? Well, as you can see, H1, again, the first thing you do in formal logic is always look for the thing you're trying to prove as the conclusion of something that you have been able to assume. So that brings us to H1, where false is the conclusion, right? And then we get to apply H1. If it'll work. There we go. And as you can see, it's trying a bunch of stuff, you know, to put in the purple boxes and give us tools that we can possibly use. Okay, and I've made this so big that it's gone off the screen and made it a little tricky for me to read. So I'm going to get out of the proof tree mode and simply look at the editor version here. Okay, yes. So we have two sub-goals. Trying to prove knight C, and we're trying to prove knight B. Okay. Let's view the proof tree again. And now, what is this current context that we're trying to, with this font size, it's a little tricky, unfortunately. So why is it we're trying to prove knight C again? Yeah, eventually. Why is that the current goal? Intros. Apply H1. Did I get that wrong? One second. I'm going to say prev, and what does that get me? Yeah. So I applied H2 intros. And let me just... This is what you've spent a lot of time doing in formal logic, actually. Looking at things and going, okay, what did I get wrong? So we have, what do we have? We have false, and that's the conclusion of H1. But is that really what I... Oh, no, because our contradiction, right. So our contradiction is actually still in H, right? Our contradiction is knight A by implies knight A, knight A implies false, or knight A implies knave A. So that's actually what we want to drive toward. The problem here, is it a problem? No, it's not a problem. So why does that not show up where I want it to? Well, anyway, there's a super helpful tactic called eliminate, or elim. And what it does is, given a whole bunch of logical connectives in any given hypothesis, it breaks them down. And then you can add them to the proof context as assumptions. And so I'm going to do that all in one fell swoop here by saying elim H, and then intros takes a bunch of stuff in the thing you're trying to prove and adds them to the context. I'm just going to try to do that as a shortcut. We'll see how this goes. Okay. Yeah, so that's helpful, because as you can see, it's added H4, which is flat out our contradiction, right? Knight A implies knight A equals false. So that's ultimately going to be the thing that that lets us prove that C is a knight. So we still have this false conclusion that we want to prove, but now it's easy because we get to apply H4, where that's our conclusion, right? False is our conclusion. And now we need to prove knight A. And again, knight A is the conclusion of one of our hypotheses, so we can just apply that again, H5. And you can see this is getting very circular, right? Now, so all of a sudden we have to prove knight A equals false again. And again, we can use intros to introduce knight A as an assumption. There we go. Knight A implies false. That's obviously a contradiction, right? So we're very, very close at this point. Now if we say apply H4 again, right, now we have to prove knight A again. Around and around and around we go. The difference at this point is that knight A is now one of our assumptions in our context. So now we can say assumption, and next, and did it take that? Oh yes, because we have to prove it several times. We're now nested several levels deep, so we have to say assumption again. And again. Oh, no such assumption. Yeah, we ran out of knight A's. Okay. Now we have to go through this all again. We still have to prove knight A, so apply H5 because knight A is the conclusion. Yeah. And knight A implies false. Intros the knight A. Oops, typo. Right. And we have to conclude false. Again, there's a contradiction, which there definitely is. Apply H4 to give us knight A, which again, we have by assumption. And again, by assumption. If I can get the cursor there we go. Right? Knight A is in our context. We're back to having to prove knight B, but now we're in a context where knight B is one of our assumptions. So we get to say assumption here. Right? Next. And here we have the traditional QED indicating that we have a successful proof. So fairly painful, fairly elaborate, lots of fiddly little, you know, apply this and assume that, and we have that in the context, it's an assumption and all that kind of stuff. So this is why a lot of people don't enjoy formal logic, right? It's, and don't enjoy necessarily using even interactive proof assistance. But just to reiterate, now that we have this, oh, and by the way, this is the proof assistant that's been used to prove the four-color map theorem, the odd order theorem, some really heavy-duty mathematics and other things. So if and when you get to this point, you'll notice that you can't edit anything that's in green. If it's in green, that means that it's been accepted, it's been checked, it's been proof checked, it's been type checked, which is the same thing. And you can't edit it because you probably don't want to throw away years and years and years and years of work, right? I am going to throw away this work. I'm going to put the caret there, and I'm going to go to caret. And I'm going to erase all this. And now I'm back to my theorem, so I'm going to go to caret again. I just want to say, yeah, this is what I want to prove. And again, just to show you why people really use proof assistance. Boom. Congratulations. We just proved exactly the same thing by saying first order, which is basically the same thing as saying, please run a prolog interpreter and solve this problem. Logically, it's the same thing. Now, just to make some more points, I'm going to close out this section. And I'm going to go down here. And it turns out that the thing you see in the pane on the left is not actually the proof. That's called a proof script, and it's specific to Coq. It's specific to this particular proof assistant. What we'd really like to know, or at least I would like to know, is what is the proof of, what did we call it, knight C, right? Unknown command of the non-proof editing mode. Did I make a typo of some kind? Of the non... Oh, yeah. Thank you. I think.
Does it need to happen inside the end? Do you do it before you end?
No, actually. Oh, that's very strange. I wonder if I can at least check it. Unknown command of non. You know, that's a good question. I don't believe so. Maybe. Maybe that's it. Yeah, thank you. That's it. I can never remember whether it needs to be uppercase or lowercase. So now if you look in the pane on the right, you'll see the actual proof, in this case the proof that Coq itself came up with when I said first order, for this theorem. And if you look at it, you'll see that it looks an awful lot like, I don't know, a Scala program, or, you know, an ML program, an OCaml program, you know, Haskell program, because it is. And this is, the language here is the calculus of inductive constructions. That's the logic that underlies this particular proof assistant, which is based on type theory. And so there are a couple of things that are maybe worth pointing out here. One is that, as you might expect, the things on the right of colons are types, and the things on the left of them are just names. You have lambdas here in the form of fun. Of course, you have the things that we named as well. Hypotheses are, you know, again, they are functions. The arrow here means implication, it means function type, they're exactly the same thing. And if we can scroll all the way to the bottom, then we see that the ultimate type of this expression says for all. And one of the things, so for all, I mean, spell this out a bit, for all natives of type set, for all knight functions of type native to prop, for all natives A, B, and C, doesn't actually matter what they are, it's true for all of them, and given these additional types, values, they're the same, it's a dependently typed language, then this is true. In other words, to put it in type terms, this type, and knight C is a perfectly fine type, this type is inhabited. There is a value of this type, or in logical terms, it has a proof. We just actually built the proof. So in terms of building a proof, what we have built is an inhabitant of this type, or a value of this type, if you prefer. Okay. So that is our first visit to the islands of knights and natives, and hopefully the next one will go a little bit smoother, but not too bad. So now I get to go back and say, hypotheses, etc. Go to caret. And get rid of all of these. So that's a taste, and I still have variables A, B, and C here. Well, I want to keep A and B, because the next one goes like this. So we're on the island of knights and natives, knights and knaves, rather, and we know it's no good to ask a native just, you know, what are you? Are you a knight or a knave? So we decide to ask both of the natives. We try to be a little more clever, right? So we ask both of the natives, are either of you knaves? And A replies and says, at least one of us is a knave. Okay, so same question. What's, in this case, actually, the question is, what is the logical situation? Is A a knight? Is B a knight? Is A a knave? Is B a knave? What is the truth of the situation logically? If we have two natives and we ask them both, ask one of them, I suppose, doesn't matter, are either of you knaves? And one of them, A in this case, says at least one of us is a knave. So first of all, given what we know about the connectives and or not implication so far, we haven't done anything with the universal and existential quantifiers. Given just those, and or not, and implication, how would you say what A says, right? So let me go ahead and say hypothesis. A says, What? How would you, you know, and or not implication? How would you say what A said? At least one of us is a knave.
Not knight A, not knight B.
Sorry?
Not knight A and B.
Not knight A and B. So.
And knight B.
And knight B.
So.
It's not the case that both A and B are knights.
It's not the case that both A and B are knights. Okay. Let me see. Not knight A and not knight B? Yeah, is there a slightly different way? I think it's easier than that.
A or B and not A and B.
Yeah. So at least one is kind of the hint, right? I heard somebody say or, so I'll just go ahead and run with that. A says, not knight A, at least, you know, not knight A or not knight B, right?
So and that's the same as what Julian said, right? Which you can move the not outside the parens and change the or to an and.
Yep. So there's one of De Morgan's laws, right?
Exactly.
So that is absolutely true. A great point, and we will come back to that. I'd like to use this what I think of as a slightly more direct representation, right? Okay. So.
Sorry, Paul, but I didn't say at least.
Sorry. Oh, so that's a good point. So if either A or B is a knave, then this disjunction will be true, right? And if they're both knaves, then this disjunction will be true. So that covers either the one knave or the two knave case, because this or is not exclusive, right? It's a very good point. Okay, so that goes through, this hypothesis goes through. And, I seem to have eliminated my place to put the theorem. But that's okay, I can put it here, it's not a problem. So our theorem, what is our theorem? Do we know what the logical situation is? Let's just say TH. And what do we want, what do we believe? What do we believe the logical situation is? A says that at least one of them is a knave, so we've translated that to knave A or knave B, right? A says knave A or knave B. Does anybody have any idea what the truth of the matter is and why? Why is the important part, right?
A knave would never say that because it would be true, because they're a knave.
Right. So that tells us we think that A is a knight. So if A is a knight, what else is implied? That B is a knave, yeah. If there's at least one knave and A is a knight, then B must be the knave. So our theorem actually is knight A and knave B. So did we do a good job? Yeah, we did well enough to make that work. So that's awesome. So I'm a big fan of making things more syntactically explicit. So I'm going to do unfold says. Oops, and I can't type. Unfold says. And unfold. Fold not in everything. Okay. Oh, something I really should have called out explicitly before, but I'll do it now. Notice that when I unfold not, that transforms the tilde whatever to whatever implies false. Okay, and that might seem a little odd, implies false. You know, what on earth does that mean? It literally means if you take the left part of the implication as an assumption, then it must imply a contradiction. It has to imply a contradiction. And again, this is a constructivist interpretation of logic. In other words, you have to be able to demonstrate algorithmically, step by step, in a finite number of steps in finite time, that there is a contradiction in your assumptions that justifies your concluding false, that the situation you have in the things that you believe to be true is contradictory. That's what implies false means. And that's why in this logic, and in all constructivist logic for that matter, negation is represented as implies false. Something implies false. The proposition implies false. So we have that here. And so what do I want to do first to prove what it is that we think we can prove? And I think the first thing to do here, because this A says is fairly complex, it really would be helpful to break it down a bit. So we can say, once again, we have a by implication, so we can destruct A says and just sort of tease out the pieces of it, both sides of that by implication, and that helps. Again, we have some just plain implications here, but it's still fairly tricky. Now we have, we still have these mouthfuls where, we'd really like to just prove knight A, but knight A is either the conclusion of this big long chain of things, or it's the first assumption of this big long chain of things. But it's actually encouraging, when you see these kinds of symmetries where, the thing you want to prove is an assumption on one end and it's the conclusion on the other end, that's a pretty good sign that you're headed in the right direction. And in particular, what I want to do here is strongly assert that this is heading in the right direction. So unfortunately, I can't point and click and do this, but what we can do is we can simply assert knight A. And what we're doing when we say assert knight A in Coq, and again, this is not a Coq tutorial, don't want to spend a lot of time with this, what we're doing is saying, I want to actually put this in the proof context now. I want to go ahead and prove this now. I think I can prove this now from what we have in the assumptions. And then if we're successful, then it'll be there with the rest of the assumptions and we'll be able to use it later. So I actually do want to do that. So that gets me there. And then again, we're saying, I think I can prove knight A. And at this point, knight A is, again, a conclusion of a hypothesis, right? So always look for the opportunity to just do apply. And the reason for that is it doesn't change anything about your proof context. You're just applying a function and getting to the next step in your proof. Okay, now this is really starting, to me, this is really starting to get interesting, because now we have to prove an OR, we have to prove a disjunction. And in order to prove a disjunction, it's kind of cool. You just get to pick the side you think is true and try to prove that. Now, of course, we're in the process of asserting that knight A is true. So I'm not going to then turn around and try to prove that knight A is false. I'm going to try to prove that knight B is false, which it is, right? That's the thing we believe is true. So we can choose either side of a disjunction. See these little arrows here. So, of course, we want to choose the right side. And so we want to prove knight B implies false. So we introduce knight B as a hypothesis. And now we say, well, we're pretty confident there's a contradiction, right? And again, always look for the thing you want to prove as the conclusion of one of your hypotheses, which we have as H, except once again, it's not just concludes false. Well, actually, yeah, it is. So I get to just apply H, it looks like. Oh, is that true? Did I get that wrong? Oh, yeah. Because it's on the right side of a disjunction itself. Okay. So I have to do something, again, a little more powerful. When there's a big collection of connectives, you want to be able to break them down and assert them individually, which is, again, a lim H. The semicolon means if this tactic generates a bunch of subgoals, the next thing you do to all of those subgoals, by the way. That's just a little detail. Don't worry too much about that. So a lim H intros, that's a really handy thing to sort of have in your back pocket. Just know that you can try that. And yeah, as you can see, it has broken out the things that were on the left side of that arrow in the hypothesis. So we have knight B as an assumption, knight A is false as an assumption. Great, so now we have false as a plain old conclusion of an implication, which means we get to use good old apply, workhorse of all of this, right? And now we're back to proving knight A again. And that now should be a simple apply, it looks like, right? Apply H0. Okay. And we again have a disjunction to prove. We get to prove which side to prove. Now, this is cool because one of our choices is knight A implies false, and that happens to be one of our hypotheses. So we can pick, we can pick left. That's what we need to pick. Yeah. Great. So now we have to prove knight A implies false. Knight A implies false is one of our assumptions, but notice that it's an implication of false. It's an implication of a contradiction. So we can prove the contradiction by saying contradiction. Okay. Now we're in a context where we're trying to prove false again, but check this out. We've got both knight B and knight B implies false as assumptions. So that's a pretty obvious contradiction, and we can say so. Okay. Now we have to prove knight A again, but we're sort of back in a context where it's not immediate, right? So it is a conclusion, though, of H0. So we apply H0 again. And now we're in a context where knight B is assumed to be true. So I'm not going to choose the right side and try to prove that knight B equals false or implies false in a context where knight B is assumed to be true. So I'm going to make the assumption that knight A implies false here. And again, introduce knight A as a hypothesis when we can. And we're back to, you know, proving the contradiction that we know we have, right? So there must be a contradiction in here, and there is, right? It's in H0. Let's see. It's false a direct conclusion of anything? No. So we have to elim. So we have to use elim again, our old favorite. And we have knight A and knight B as assumptions, so that suggests maybe elim H0 and intros. Let's try that. No. Oh, not an inductive product, right. So I chose the wrong one. Elim H intros go to caret. Yeah. Right. So it's, again, elim takes all the things that are joined by logical connectives and sort of splits them out, and then intros puts them back in as individual assumptions. So that's handy because...
Manually.
Sorry?
Why are you doing this manually?
To demonstrate the reasoning about the connectives. Like, how do you, when you do actually break these things down, what do you get? You know, you get these hypotheses that you couldn't justify otherwise. So the point there is they're buried, you know, these connectives are sort of burying things that you can assume to be true for the purpose of doing the proof. And then you sort of pull them out and then you put those assertions back in and that's actually a really good callback to the point about formalism. You know, we can look at this hypothesis, we can look at any of these problems and say, well, it's trivial, it's obvious, you know, why bother? And all of these exercises are about kind of building the context in which you can reason about the logic step by step, piece by piece by piece. It's totally true that first order will take care of this one, you know, instantaneously, just like it did the first one. But I want to get people thinking about how it is that you actually do logic with each individual connective and or not. You know, in this case, for example, I mean, this is another simple one. We have a contradiction in the context, right? But it's a little more interesting when we have, you know, like a disjunction as our goal, and we have to pick a side, and that we have to look at the context and see what we can reasonably, you know, which side we can reasonably believe we can prove, you know, based on the context that we have, and so on and so forth. But it is true that all of the things that we're doing here today are completely trivial for a computer to do, right? So this is a strictly formal exercise in that sense. I'm not suggesting that this is the way anybody should actually prove any of these things, you know, not at all, except to build understanding, right? The only reason to use these very basic approaches, these fundamental, you know, avoid the automation, you know, that the tool gives you, is in order to build understanding. That's the only reason. We have another contradiction. Great. And here, finally, we have knight A is one of our assumptions, as is knight B. So we're sort of on easy street right at the moment. So we make that assumption. And now this is great, because remember, a while back now, we said assert knight A, and we've just proven it. So now we're back to our original goal, which is to prove knight A and knight B implies false. So to prove a conjunction, as opposed to a disjunction, remember, with a disjunction, we get to choose a side, right? We think either the left side is true or the right side is true. With a conjunction, we have to prove both sides, right? It's and. So we have to prove the left side and we have to prove the right side. So the way we do that is to say split, which splits the conjunction into its two sides, right? And so the left side of that was knight A, which we just spent the entire, you know, previous 10 minutes or more proving. So that's now an assumption. Yay! World's easiest proof, you know, assumption, right? We already know it. We get to intro knight B as an assumption in order to prove a contradiction. And we can do that fairly easily. Again, we have to, you know, where is false? False is in H, but it's buried by a bunch of logical connectives. So we do lim H again, intros again, just to break all that stuff out. And sure enough, when we do that, we find that we have, as assumptions, both knight A and knight A implies false, which is a contradiction. That's about as easy as that gets. And again, a contradiction, knight B and knight B implies false. We wait for it to catch up. There we go. And once again, knight A is one of our assumptions. I love it when, you know, you have knight A and knight B and it's all just like, well, there's obviously a contradiction in there somewhere, right? Or an assumption. And so we say assumption, QED. Yep, so that was the right answer. It is true that A is a knight and B is a knave. And now the computer has checked it for us. And again, if we want to print, you know, print the theorem, and we constructed this one by hand, so let's actually look at it. And what did we call it? I called it something very uninteresting, yeah, TH. Yeah. So one of the things I guess I should point out explicitly, although I'm sure everybody has caught on, is that we are going through this fairly elaborate process to write a function. And we have the ability to print that function, you know, when we're done and when we want to. And again, I want to call out the fact that its type says for all. So it doesn't matter what natives you choose, what you call them, you know, AB, ABC, doesn't matter. You can pass any natives there you want, and this statement will be true. And so one of the things that those of you who have seen Amanda's and my previous presentations, where we talk about types having universal quantification and tests having existential quantification, this is what we mean about the universal quantification side of that. If you have a function that takes you know, arguments of a particular type and yields results of a particular type, then it's going to do that for all values of that type. It just so happens that in a dependently typed system like this one, that universal quantification is spelled out explicitly. But as functional programmers, and I'll talk about this a bit more at the end, as functional programmers, this is true. It's just true. This is why we do it. We do it so that we can reason about the function. We can say, no matter what value you pass here, you're going to get a value of this other type when the function is done. And all we've done here is build such a function in a fairly elaborate way. Which again, just to prove the point, I can get rid of all of this. And that is my theorem. And I can go back there, and I can say first order. This is all perfectly good first order logic. Whoops, typo. All lovely first order logic, and boom. we haven't even gotten. So I guess I should also point out, as a matter of formal logic, both of the puzzles that we've done so far are just in a fragment of logic called propositional logic. And propositional logic is decidable. It's always possible to determine whether just a propositional logic statement is true or false. It can be entirely mechanical. So there's no way that the computer can fail to solve this problem. That's about to change. So let me actually go all the way back to the beginning here and reload my template, because I erased part of it inadvertently. Okay, not that it matters. In fact, it doesn't matter at all. So that's a couple of questions that we've had on the islands of Knights and Knaves. So what's the third one? The third one, and last one, so good news, is we're on the island of Knights and Knaves, and we know that either everybody on this island is a knight, or everybody on this island is a knave. And we talked to, actually, it's a small island, so we talked to all of the natives. And all of the natives say, somebody else on the island, there is some of the other natives smoke. I don't smoke, but some of the other natives smoke. What can we infer about, what's the truth of the situation here? What can we say about this? And again, as always, we want to put our what we know in place, right? So first, we have a new predicate, actually, which is smokes, which is a proposition about natives. Natives may smoke. And what else? We have hypothesis. What was the first thing that we were told? We were told that everybody is the same, right? Either everybody is a knight or everybody is a knave. So how will we express that? Or, right? So either for all natives, for all native, knight n, or there we go, or for all n native, not knight n. And the other thing we were told is that all natives say some natives smoke, but I don't. Okay, so let's call this hypothesis someone else smokes. And that is for all n of type native, n says, and what does n say? N says, there exists some other native, at least one other native, who smokes.
And
very good, not smokes N. Right? Now, first question, did I express that correctly? And it looks like I did not. All N native. Oh, thank you. Hypothesis, what is this? Oh, yeah. Let's call it same type, right? And yeah, that should do. Go to caret. Yeah, okay. So our hypotheses have gone through, right? Now we need a theorem.
Is the last hypothesis correct? Did you ask all of them, or did you ask just one of them?
So someone else smokes. Sorry, the question was, is the last hypothesis correct? Does it accurately model what we were told, right? Very good question. It's a little tricky. So what we've said here formally is, for all natives say that there exists at least one other native who smokes, and they themselves, whichever N we're talking about, does not smoke. But it is very important to this particular puzzle that you understand that N ranges over all the natives on the island, right? Doesn't matter which one you talk to. They all say, some other natives smoke, but I don't. Right? All of them say that. So that actually is pretty much all you need, I think, to figure out what we can prove, right? What is the truth of the situation? Anybody want to take a stab at it?
They're all knaves.
And nobody smokes. Okay. Can we actually infer that?
That last part isn't totally guaranteed. Everyone can smoke.
So let's start with the first assumption, right?
Yeah.
So let's assume that they're all knaves. Okay. So if they're all knaves, they say somebody else on the island smokes, and I don't. So if they're a knave, then either of those sides of the and could be false, right? To falsify the conjunction.
Yeah.
And that would satisfy them being a knave, right? They're not telling the whole truth, right? Either side of that conjunction could be true. But if the other side is false, they're still not telling the truth, and they're still a knave, and everything is consistent, right? So the problem that we run into is making that determination, right? So one side of the conjunction is somebody else, there exists, there's at least one other native that smokes, and I don't. So if they're a knave, then that has to be contradictory some way, right? Now the question is, can we use that to demonstrate either that everyone smokes or everyone does not smoke? And how are we doing for time? Does anybody?
We have 8 minutes.
Oh, 8 minutes? Wow, I am way over. Okay. Actually, given that, thank you for that. I'm going to cut this one short because we're so badly over. The answer to this one is indeed that all the natives are knaves. I think that's fairly obvious. Unfortunately, I don't have time to actually run through the proof. But the big takeaway that I wanted to get out of this proof is that universal quantification, which would get introduced into the context in the process of doing the proof, also works exactly the same as implication. But we've really sort of already talked about that. But something to bear in mind is that in formal logic, especially at least in constructivist logic, universal quantification is the same thing as implication. And in fact, if I had a goal that said for all and I said intros, you would notice that the for all went away, and it just introduces the name of the thing to the left, the thing being quantified. It just introduces into the context as an assumption. So anything you prove from that will be true for all of the values of that type. And by the way, in case it wasn't already obvious, when you look at the proof context and you've got your assumptions, hypotheses, all that kind of stuff, the stuff on the right of the colon, you might think, oh, it's on the right of a colon, looks like a type. It is. That brings us to the ultimate point, actually, of all of this, which is a quick, let me see, how do I get to the top? There we go. Which I wanted to be, and I'm going to still try to do, a quick reconstruction, tutorial reconstruction, if you will, of an old blog post of Miles Sabin's, actually. which is unboxed union types in Scala via the Curry-Howard isomorphism. Okay, and I think we've got enough in place to actually whip through this very, very quickly. But the observation, the brilliant observation that Miles made is, we have what we call product types in Scala. Those are native, and we don't have negation at the type level. Again, remember, types are propositions. So when we think about union types, which are also called sum types, and in fact I prefer to call them sum types. So we have sum and product types. Product types we have explicitly. There's a type in Scala called product. Sum types, not so much. We have, of course, either if you're a Scala Z user, you have disjunction with the V, so that's, you know, straight out of this stuff, right? But what Miles said was, well, could we actually get the compiler to give us a nice compile time, you know, or this type or that type, without boxing, so, you know, strictly using the type system. And the brilliant key insight, there are a couple of them actually, as usual, that Miles had, is that you can use De Morgan's law, right, in which you can express or in terms of and not. So to solve this problem, to provide an OR type, which Scala doesn't have natively. And given that it does have product types, and you can actually fake negation. And remember I said earlier that in constructive logic, in constructivist logic, negation implies false, right? We saw that with both of the puzzles that we did. So implies false is negation. And remember, the arrow type is either implication or a function type. Well, obviously we have function types in Scala. What would false be? Hopefully nobody's cheating by reading the blog post. And I also said that we're concerned with provability, and so for something to be false simply means that it doesn't have a proof. And I also said that programs are proofs. So what's a type in Scala that has no proofs or has no values, if you want to look at it that way?
Nothing.
Nothing, yeah, exactly. So it turns out that, and this is just brilliant on Miles' part, I wish I had this insight, I didn't, Miles did, that you can use arrow nothing, or a function that returns nothing, to represent negation. And so what Miles did in order to build his unboxed union type was to say, well, I can make a type, and here he uses the traditional negation symbol, and says, you know, that's implies, or sorry, arrow nothing. Did he do that up here somewhere, maybe? Yeah, there we go. Yeah, type not of A, is A implies nothing. The product type, you can build a product type in Scala out of arbitrary types by using with, right? So this with that, gives you the product type of those two types. And so using De Morgan's law, which you can use to turn not, and we just talked about that earlier, right? You can represent OR as not, open parentheses, not A, and not B, close parentheses. So we have and in Scala, that's with. We have not in the form of function type returning nothing. And then using all of that, Miles implemented an unboxed sum type, as I prefer to call it, in terms of product types and implies nothing. And that is the point, as far as I'm concerned. Anytime people like Amanda or I or Runar or Daniel Spiewak or, you know, all of us who go on and on about statically typed functional programming talk about being able to reason about our code, This is what we mean, and I'm really going to have to wrap this up and try to leave just a few minutes for questions. But let me go back to the slides at this point, just for a few more comments. Back to logic, or back to the history of logic. So Alonzo Church came up with the lambda calculus. It was supposed to be a logic, which means it was supposed to be sound. Bad news. In the 1930s, a couple of other of Alonzo Church's students found out that you could actually, they proved that the lambda calculus, the untyped lambda calculus, is unsound. And it turns out that the proof that the lambda calculus is unsound is called the Y combinator, and is how you do general recursion in the untyped lambda calculus. Okay, So it turns out general recursion is logical inconsistency. Okay? So you cannot reason about your code in the presence of general recursion. Okay? And this is why I want to emphasize that the lambda calculus was a logic from day one. It was a formal logic from day one. It was proven inconsistent, and that's why we have types. And in fact, even the simply typed lambda calculus introduces, or I should say enforces, consistency in the lambda calculus. So that's why we have types. Okay, I got a little ahead of myself. We already talked about the unboxed union type. Okay, major takeaways. Yeah, the big one, if you get nothing else out of this, walk out of here with nothing else. Well, really two of them. So a function from A to B means for all values A of type A, there exists some value B of type B such that B equals F of A. That's what you're promising with that function signature, right? That's what that means. Now, underneath that, you see, might see I have a pretty, you know, straightforward function signature, factorial, factorial of int. Anybody have any idea what's wrong with that other than Eric? You're disqualified. Exactly, yeah. Factorial is not defined on all the integers. You cannot pass a negative integer to factorial and have it mean anything. You have to throw an exception, you have to loop forever. There's your logical inconsistency. So either we have to make the domain smaller, and we can do that with shapeless, another piece of genius work from Miles. We can use the nat type, right? Because factorial is defined on nats. And so if we change this to nat, we can always actually return a value, although Runar pointed out another issue, which is that int is too small, right? You very rapidly get overflow if you actually use int. So if we had nat to sort of big int or something like that, we could actually implement factorial correctly. But the thing, again, the thing I want to emphasize is if your function is not defined for every value in the domain, which is called a partial function, as opposed to a total function, you've heard some folks talk about total functions, then you run the risk of logical inconsistency. You run the risk of introducing this inconsistency that is revealed by throwing exceptions or going into an infinite loop or crashing. So when we advocate functional programming, those of us who do, we should also be clear that we're advocating total functional programming, no partial functions, okay? If you actually want to be able to reason about your code logically, then your functions do need to be total. And I said one way to do that is to shrink the domain. That's true. Sometimes you can't. Sometimes you have to talk to the outside world, and that can fail and all that kind of stuff. So the other way to make a partial function total is to make the codomain larger. And that's why we have failure monads like any number of them, either or validation or disjunction, you know, all of those types that we use to say something went wrong, right? And we can capture the fact that something went wrong and still have a total function, just with a larger codomain that represents both the success and failure cases. And we can still reason about our code that way, which is super important. But the most important thing that I want to leave you with is this, that logic is to the mind as the lever is to muscle, okay? Those of us who study logic have been entrusted with the only grimoire that actually works as advertised, okay? It is magic. It is the only magic that actually works. Logic is to mind as lever is to muscle. The lever changed the human race. Logic also changes the human race. What next? Obviously the rest of Scala World. I mean, this kind of stuff is a major theme, thankfully, here at Scala World. So I'm super happy about that. Work through the rest of Logical Labyrinths. Work through the Little Prover, which was just published in July. Gosh, there's too much here to really go through, and we are totally out of time. Idris is a floor-topping and a dessert wax. It's a proof assistant and a programming language. I strongly encourage you to see Edwin's work on that. Go talk to him. And I will leave you with this closing note from George Boole, since it's its 200th anniversary of his birth, and there are celebrations throughout what remains of the year. But this is a very important point about the limits of logic with respect to being human. And I am way out of time. Thank you so much, all, for joining me. And Questions, maybe. I guess we did a pretty good job during, but hopefully we have a few minutes to take any questions that anybody has. I can't actually see if anybody's raising their hand, so just shout out.
One weird thing I noticed in when you were using the proof assistant, a bunch of the propositions had like some proposition or false. I mean, and false.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I guess the question would be, if it has, you know, A or false, why wasn't it simplifying it at some earlier stage? It seems like that's something you could do very quickly.
It totally is. So Coq in particular, so back to the issue of being formal and shoving symbols around, right? Yes, it's certainly possible to have really ridiculously simple simplification rules for certain propositional tautologies like that. You know, anything or false, you know, A or false is A, right? And of course, people like De Morgan worked all that out back in the 19th century. I'm sure people actually worked that sort of thing out even earlier. As far as why the proof assistant doesn't do it, it actually does, at least if you ask it to. So there are situations, I didn't look at anywhere near all of the tactics that were suggested to apply to solving any of these goals, because there just isn't time, and there are too many, and we're already over time. But yes, there is a tactic called simple, which for some strange reason drops the E at the end, so it's S-I-M-P-L. And that simplifies, it tries to simplify certain logical expressions according to various identities that it knows about and all that kind of stuff, and that works really well. So there's actually a spectrum, especially in the propositional fragment, where you can do anything from bang on things at the lowest possible level, which is what I did here, try to educate, to all the way out to the first order tactic, which basically tries to solve the whole thing and succeeds with all three of these puzzles for sure. None of them are at all logically difficult. And in between there are things like the simple tactic and things like that. But again, I'm not trying to teach Coq here. I wanted to try to talk a little bit about how the connectives actually work. What is the mental process by which you break them down and say, okay, I prove a disjunction by picking a side that I think I can prove. You know, when I have a conjunction, I have to prove both sides. When I have an implication, I get to assume the thing on the left-hand side and then demonstrate that what's left on the right-hand side of the arrow follows once I've assumed the thing on the left-hand side, right? Given all the other assumptions that I brought along for the ride, right? The other hypotheses and all that sort of thing. But yes, modern proof assistants are unbelievably powerful. Again, this particular one is the one that was used to prove the four-color map theorem, finally. Is the one that was used to prove the odd order theorem, is the one used to develop the certified C compiler CompCert. So we have now a C compiler that is proven to generate the same object code that means the same thing as the source code, given the constraints of the C language, including that there are parts of it that are undefined, right? Huge, 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 massive, impressive developments done with this tool. Which again is why you're not allowed to erase things that work. It would be bad news if you got to like right before the QED on the four-color map theorem and oh no, I fat-fingered the proof, you know. So you don't get to do that. But good question. Can the tool do a better job of simplifying thing intermediate steps as you're doing these proofs? Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Anything else? Again, speak up, I can't see you.
Probably out of time, Paul.
Yeah, right.
We're leaving via the door in the top corner there.